Alright guys, so here we are for the TNA Lockdown 2013 pay-per-view review. We will kick the action off with the X Division Championship matchup, which featured champion Kenny King taking on Christian York and Zema Ion in a triple threat matchup. This was a very good way to start the show off, in my honest opinion. For more than one reason. I mean, the first of reasons is obviously because it's fast-paced action. That's what the X Division is going to bring you. And secondly, it's obviously a great way to get the crowd into the show from the get-go. You want the crowd to be, you know, invested from the first minute. And this match was actually pretty damn good. There was some innovation here. I felt like all three guys were constantly involved. It wasn't just like a lot of triple threat matches where two guys fight and then another guy comes in and then one guy's always down and two guys are always fighting. These three guys worked very well together. There was a huge Kenny King botch at the beginning though, where he almost like broke his fucking neck because he tried to use Zema Ion as like a cat. Like when he went for like a springboard backflip, he decided to try to use Zema Ion's back as like ground to try to jump off of, and it didn't fucking work out, and he almost like broke his neck. That was a very scary spot. But anyway, Kenny King ends up retaining via Royal Flush on Christian York. Good way to get Kenny King to retain. I wasn't expecting a new champion here tonight anyway. Pretty good match, went about 10 minutes. Like I said, hot, fast-paced action, gets the crowd into it. And that's no better way to start this show off. A shame that this match didn't get any build-up to it, but it was still pretty damn good. I'll give it a 3.5 out of 5. We move on to another match with absolutely zero build. Joseph Park takes on Joey Ryan. Thankfully, this match was only 5 minutes long. They tried to fit in a little build up ahead of time. It's had like a little pre-match promo where Joey Ryan just says that Joseph Park is fat and that he's not really doesn't have any talent, that, you know, he's bringing Sleaze back and this, that, the other. He has size where size matters, which was funny. So the match was a little entertaining, you know, a couple of funny spots, you know. It was more of a, like, yeah, you'd see this on TV and laugh at it, but on pay-per-view, you're kind of like, why is this happening? And you're mainly asking yourself, why is this happening? For first of all, the fact that it's Lockdown, one of the biggest pay-per-views for TNA of the year. And secondly, also because, you know, why is this match even happening? There's no build-up to it. It was never even mentioned on TV. Joey Ryan hasn't been on TV in weeks. Joseph Park has been like backstage segments with Hogan, but he hasn't done anything with Joey Ryan. So it was random. Only went 5 minutes. Literally, Joey Ryan tried to tried to get Joseph Park down so he could roll him up and get a pinfall on him. And Joseph Park literally just sat down on Joey Ryan and, you know, got the 3 count. So Joey Ryan, like I said in my predictions video, is going to remain pretty much a jobber. I can see it coming. It's too bad because Joey Ryan's actually very talented. But, you know, I see that happening. Joseph Park, not really sure what they're going to do with him, but this match was no five-star classic by any means. I'll give it like a 2 out of 5. I'll give it one thing. At least it was fairly entertaining at times. But the match itself, quality-wise, was really bad. So Bully Ray and Hulk Hogan have a little backstage segment where basically Hogan's kind of like motivating Bully, saying that he knows that TNA can be launched to a whole new level with him as the champion and that he wants the title in his family again, even though he knows he can't do it himself. He's glad that Bully's made Brooke happy again after all the time of family issues he's had in the past. And so it was nice with like the motivation factor, but it was kind of like cheesy at the same time. They're like, I love you and shit, when like 4 weeks, wasn't it like 3-4 weeks ago when they didn't like each other at all? Bully Ray tried to get Hogan to like him, but Hogan was like, I don't like him, I don't trust him, dude. But yeah, so they have a nice little sentimental backstage segment leading up to the world title match later on in the night. Oh boy, was that a good one. I can't wait to talk about that. Knockouts title match was next. Velvet Sky retains over Gail Kim. Taryn Terrell goes ape shit on Gail Kim, spearing her and beating the hell out of her because Gail Kim was slapping her and abusing her because of the fact that she kept getting near falls on Velvet Sky and kept saying that was a 3 count instead of, you know, being the normal heel. So Taryn Terrell goes ape shit crazy. And then obviously right after that, Velvet Sky hits her finisher and pins Gail Kim. Later on in the night, Gail Kim tackles Terrence Rowe backstage and they fight more. So basically all of me at this point is saying, I think Terrence Rowe is going to move from just being referee to actual wrestler. What a way to start it off with a feud with Gail Kim. I'm not sure how good she is in ring. I've never really seen any of her matches before, because all I can remember her from really from WWE is her being GM of ECW. I don't really remember. She probably wrestled a few matches, but she was so unmemorable that I don't fucking remember her wrestling a few matches. So Drew McIntyre must have felt some of that rage of Terrence Rowe. My God. So they're probably going to get into a feud. Velvet Sky remains champion. No real surprise there. Standard knockouts match. Wasn't too bad. Definitely wasn't a bad match for knockouts. Give it like a 1.75 out of 5. I honestly got a couple of nice laughs out of the whole Terrence Rowe thing. And the match itself really wasn't that bad. Again, not a tremendous amount of build-up, but I'm not going to really shit on it. Again, not a great knockouts match, but not that terrible. Next was worst match of the night by far. The Robbies, Robbie E and Robbie T, their long-standing friendship, partnership ended finally a couple weeks ago, and now Robbie E and Robbie T are fighting in a match, and Robbie T literally gets in all the offense and just wins within like 5 minutes. Awful match. I'm literally just going to give it a 1 out of 5 because it was so bad. I couldn't believe this was happening on pay-per-view. Not only that, but I hate Robbie E, and Robbie T is really just a bodybuilder. The fact that they introduced him from the Jersey Shore is just like, are you kidding me? The man's from the fucking UK. I just honestly hated this match. really bad. Really bad. At this point, I was getting a little worried about lockdown, but things would pick up in the second half of the card. It got a lot better, starting with the Triple Threat Tag Team title match, which saw Chavo Hernandez, Bad Influence, a.k.a. Kaz and Daniels, and Roode and Aries go at it in a triple threat, as I already said. Roode and Aries, the champions going into it. Thankfully, Bobby Roode was apparently re-signed to a deal earlier today because Bruce Pritchard forgot to re-sign Bobby Roode. From what I've heard, that's just a rumor, not necessarily true. But if that is true, Bruce Pritchard, slap yourself in the face a couple of times. When you almost just fucked one of your best talents over. Just saying. This match went about 15 or so. Very good action. It really took a couple of minutes for it to pick up, but once it did, it really got going. Some awesome tag team action here. I'll say, crowd was pretty behind Chavo and Hernandez, and for good reason. They performed very well in this match. I'm not going to lie, they've been kind of a boring tag team that I haven't really enjoyed that much. At first, I was into them, and then I was kind of like, yeah, it's starting to get kind of like stale. And this match, they looked very good, both of them. Big props to each of them for looking so good. Kaz and Daniels, entertaining, funny, as always. They just have great chemistry together, and they had great chemistry primarily with Roode and Aries. Those two teams are ridiculous with each other, in my opinion. Aries and Roode with each other even have great chemistry, as was noticed when they were feuding one-on-one. Now together, they work very well too. This match, this is what tag team wrestling is all about to me. I think this exemplified what I want to see. Now it's a shame the TNA's tag team division has run very thin, because you think they used to have teams like Motor City Machine Guns, Beer Money, Roode is one of those guys that's already in this tag team match, but still, they had Beer Money, they had MCMG, they had Generation Me, Team 3D, even Inc. for Christ's sake. They had all these different teams that were around, and that was only within a couple of years ago. Even Magnus and Joe, the British Invasion, for Christ's sake, Williams and Magnus. Even the Robbies, as awful as they were as a team, were another team that's now not there. So their tag team division is very thin, but these are the three best teams they currently have all put together in a great match. So not going to complain. And Roode and Aries end up retaining. It was funny. Chavo and Hernandez were set up for like that beautiful face victory where Chavo was like on the rope, like struggling just to get up and get in the frog splash off. And he did hit the frog splash. But the thing is, Roode tagged himself in just in time. Literally, he was going just about to leave the top rope, and Roode tapped him softly enough so that he was tagged legal, but yet Chavo hit the frog splash on, it was either Kaz or Daniels, and then, I think it was Daniels, and then, so Roode just tosses him out of the ring, tosses Guerrero out of the ring, gets the cover and the 1-2-3. Funny heel win. I'm glad they retained the titles. Very good match. Fucking awesome. I loved it. So I'll give it a 4 out of 5. Very good stuff. Definitely great. Steel cage match between Wes Brisco and Kurt Angle. Honestly, it wasn't too bad. It wasn't great at all. Don't get that impression from me, but I'm not going to really shit on this match. Kurt Angle got in like 80% of the offense, which to me is a little disappointing. I want to see Wes Brisco do a little more damage here. But Wes Brisco, by nook and by crook, wins this match, obviously with the help of aces and eights, because Angle won this match twice. Referee got taken out. Basically, Kurt went for a clothesline. Referee gets taken out. You know, the standard tactic that usually leads to a heel victory, as it did here. He ends up making Brisco tap out after the ref's already down. He even leaves the cage itself after the referee was down. Referee was still down, so D'Lo Brown comes in, smashes Angle off the cage, throws him back in, drags Brisco out. Referee gets up just in time to see Brisco's out, rings the bell, so Wes Brisco wins via escape cage. So, yeah, it was by nook and by crook. Yeah, it looked cheap. Yeah, Brisco looked kind of weak against Kurt Angle, as you would kind of expect that, though, because Kurt Angle was like his mentor. So, but at the same time, I want to see Wes Brisco get in a little more offense here. But overall, it really wasn't too bad. Told a good enough story. And at the end of the day, aces and eights gets a victory, which they need. So it was okay. It was like 12, 13 minutes. Solid cage match. And again, like I said, aces and eights gets a win. So I'll give it like a 2.75. I'll go 3 out of 5. 3 out of 5. Decent match. And then next we had the Lethal Lockdown, which was Team TNA and Aces and Eights. No surprise here, Team TNA goes over, which was the team of Magnus, Samoa Joe, Eric Young, James Storm, and Sting. And Team of Aces and Eights was Mr. Anderson, Knox, apparently he's not Mike Knox, he's just Knox, Garett, Bischoff, Devon, and Doc, a.k.a. Luke Gallows, for those that don't know. Went around 20-25, was a good match. Honestly, it was good. Alright, I'm not going to like praise this up the ass. This was not the best Lethal Lockdown by any fucking means. This was not even close to a great Lethal Lockdown, in my opinion. It was a decent Lethal Lockdown. It was kind of slow throughout. I'm used to more of a fast-paced Lethal Lockdown. It was kind of just didn't really get going that well to me. I miss the days when the cage, like, you know, the weapons used to come down from the cage. Like, the roof would be lowered down, the weapons would be there, guys would, like, climb up to get the weapons and then just start whacking away. Instead, what happened is Sting brings in the weapon, because this is really fair, right? So Sting gets to bring in all the weapons for his team, but Aces and Eights doesn't get to for their team. That doesn't even make any sense, in all honesty. But yeah, so Sting basically brings in all the weapons because he was the last guy in for Team TNA, no surprise, because they don't want him to work for too long. Two really awesome spots, though, toward the end of the match. One was this enormous, huge, I don't even know how to describe it, but it was like a superplex, a powerbomb, and like, it was like six guys. Garett Bischoff was involved, and I believe Storm was involved. Two more Aces and Eights members were involved. They were going to try to get him off the cage to let Garett escape, which makes no sense anyway, because that doesn't win them the match. And I don't think it did. I'm pretty sure the only way to win the Lethal Lockdown was by pinfall or submission. At least it used to be, because the roof used to come down and there was no way to escape. And then Samoa Joe was on the bottom, and literally they all just crumbled. So that was a kind of a cool, like, Tower of Doom or whatever you want to call it. And then one awesome spot at the end was Eric Young climbing all the way to the very, very top of the cage, doing a huge elbow drop, which actually won the match for Team TNA. Now, not surprised that Team TNA won, but they really kind of dominated that match, a lot of it. Honestly, Aces and Eights with the man advantage and everything, you would think that the psychology would have been Aces and Eights really dominates the match, like, for the good part of it. And yeah, TNA maybe comes back and does win. But it felt like TNA always had the upper hand over Aces and Eights the whole way. So that, to me, was kind of, it was lacking a good psychology to it. Again, that's me being maybe a little too critical, because I don't think it was a bad match. But once the weapons were brought in, Team TNA just completely dominated. The ring felt very crowded here. Normally, when you have this, yeah, there is 10 guys in the cage regardless, but it doesn't feel so crowded. This just felt like everybody was just not, I don't know. It was hard to follow the action. It really wasn't as impressive as it normally is, because you didn't have as many great wrestlers in there as you might normally have. And not only that, but I won't even say that as much as I'll say Aces and Eights guys really haven't worked that much. I mean, how many matches has Mike Knox really worked yet? Or Doc, even? I thought it was just all right. And obviously, Garett Bischoff sucks, so... it was decent. I'll give it like a 3.25 out of 5. I would have rather seen, obviously, Aces and Eights win here. Now, why do I seem so Aces and Eights, like, you know, wanting them to win every match? Well, here, let me just ask you a question. How legitimate is a stable supposed to be taken? Because you can tell it's Aces and Eights apparently is probably going to be around for a lot longer. How legitimate do they really look if they lose every fucking match they're involved in? I mean, I'm just asking a simple question, because you know what? They've lost every match they've been involved in so far. So my question as a fan is, you know, don't they need wins? Yes, they do. If they dominate Lockdown, all of a sudden you start taking them a little more seriously. And they're supposed to be a big cohesive unit that works well together, right? So if five of them couldn't beat five of TNA's guys, one of which was a joke character for a long time, one of which was pretty much a jobber heel, a guy that is in his 50s, you know, I'm just saying, like, three of the five guys on that team, and Samoa Joe was a jobber for quite a bit until the last year or so, and James Storm really hasn't had a place the last 6 months or more. I'm just saying, like, these guys are legitimate, no doubt, but I'm just saying they should be able to, if Aces and Eights is taking over, they're tough, they're a biker gang, they work so well together, why shouldn't they be able to beat these guys? Anyway, I move on to the main event. Bully Ray, Jeff Hardy for the World Heavyweight Championship. And it was a pretty good match. Now, I'll just talk about the match first. It was a good steel cage match, and they were trying to, I know Hardy and Storm, Hardy and Bully Ray were trying to hype it up. Obviously, they're going to try to do whatever they can to hype the match up. I get what they're trying to do. They're trying to, you know, using good promotion. That's fine. But it was by far not even ever going to be close to the best cage match. That's not even a question. Second part to that is that it never really picked up that well, in my opinion. There was a couple of big spots, like Bully Ray powerbombed him off the top rope. That was pretty awesome. Hardy hit like two twist of fates. There's a couple of close escape moments through the door and through, Hardy almost escaped a few times. Several near falls. It was a pretty good match, but it never really went far. It wasn't a great match by any stretch of the imagination, but it was the ending that was so great. So early in the match, Brisco and Bischoff came in, you know, to try to interrupt this match, and Bully and Jeff Hardy worked together to toss them out, so they got back to the action. Later on, the more of Aces and Eights comes in. They both have a chain to try to work together again, and they're facing back-to-back. Like, you know how, like, two guys are, like, trying to fight a bunch of other guys off in, like, a movie or whatever, and they're always, like, facing each other back-to-back? You know how that always fucking happens? So they were doing that. And then all of a sudden, Devon tosses down the hammer that's been used to, like, take people out, to Bully Ray. And so, obviously, it doesn't take any rocket scientist to figure out that Bully Ray is part of Aces and Eights. He smashes Jeff Hardy with the hammer and gets the pinfall and wins the World Heavyweight Championship and is the president of Aces and Eights, tells Brooke to let that bitch cry, and says to Hogan, go fuck yourself, and tells the crowd to screw off, and the crowd's throwing fucking trash over the steel cage and into the ring, and it was just the coolest ending, I think, to this pay-per-view. I don't care what anybody has to say. I honestly thought this pay-per-view was pretty good, and then this ending was great. I thought it told a great story. Bully Ray literally just used everyone to get to where he got. He turned face, you know, basically, let's just think about this. He turned face, he, you know, got with Brooke Hogan, married her, earned Hulk Hogan's trust, got into the main event because of Hulk Hogan's trust and through obvious nepotism that Hogan would use, because that's, dude, obviously, brother. So you get all of that thrown into the picture, and then he just stabs them all in the back And he's part of Aces and Eights. He was the whole time. He's the big bad bully he always was. Just played us all off. And it was awesome. And it was an awesome moment. Because, you know what? I think anybody could say he might have been part of the Aces and Eights. Like, you could have guessed that. It could have gone either way. You could have said, yeah, there's a possibility he's part of Aces and Eights or the president or whatever. But there's also a possibility that he has nothing to do with them. You know, I think I've definitely thought about it, but I never, like, said it's definitely possible. Like, I never said it was, like, 100% sure. I just thought it was maybe a possibility. Well, it sure as hell was, because he is the president and he's the world champion. So, literally, he manipulated all of us and Hogan and the Hogan family and TNA and everybody to get into the main event and earn Jeff Hardy's trust, had the respectful, you know, match outlook and everything. And he looked like he was always ready to fight off Aces and Eights and everything. That's why they always just ran away every time he, I mean, maybe not, maybe they didn't book it as well as I'm thinking, and I'm jumping the gun on that, but I'm thinking every time he comes into the ring with his chain, they all just disperse, they run away, they don't really do anything. Now, I will say at first, he had a couple of matches against them and everything. He worked with Sting. He earned everyone's trust and became a complete babyface. And everybody was behind him. And now, oh man, how much better can you draw heat and become the top heel in the whole company just by doing that? By just stabbing everybody in the back and doing the 180 and being that heel that you always were before. I love it. I love it, man. It brings a smile on my face just thinking about it because it was so well executed, in my opinion. I thought it was great. And now he's your world champion, finally. He deserves a world title run, and I'm glad he's getting one. I'm glad they finally put the belt on him. He literally just won the world title for Aces and Eights. He's the president of Aces and Eights. And boy, doesn't it make everybody think a little better of Aces and Eights and think, man, now they have the world title in their possession. I give a fuck about them for once. Well, yeah. It's a shame that they couldn't have been built up any better over the whole course of the time that they've been around. But you know what? At least now we can say, I give a little bit of a shit. They can be taken a little more seriously. Maybe this can be a sign of good things to come for Aces and Eights. I don't want it to see Aces and Eights fail, but I've hated the angle from pretty much the get-go. And this is the coolest thing that they've done by far. I'm not going to jump on the bandwagon and say they're definitely going to be awesome now, because that probably won't happen. But this was an awesome moment, and this could lead to something very good for Aces and Eights. Let's hope for the best. All they needed to do was win that Lethal Lockdown match. They would have had complete control at Lockdown. They would have looked completely dominant. And all of a sudden, Aces and Eights is starting to look a little more credible. But they still look a little more credible just because they now have the world title in their possession. That one thing alone does so much for them. And that was an awesome finish to the pay-per-view to draw so much heat. I loved it. I thought it was great. So I'm going to give that whole thing combined a 4 out of 5 because I just love that finish so much. I'll even give it a 4 and a quarter out of 5 just because it was so cool. So, again, let's get to the overall here. Now, I thought Taz did a really good job on some heel commentary tonight. I think he did very well throughout the evening with that. He was such an asshole to Tanae and the other guy. I don't even know what the hell his name is still. But, you know, honestly, I thought he did some very good heel commentary tonight. And I thought there were some good matches. The X Division title opener was impressive. And it got the crowd into it very quickly. I honestly thought the World Tag Title match was extremely good. The Steel Cage with Brisco and Angle. The Lethal Lockdown match was at least pretty damn good. Like, you know, it wasn't, again, it was good. It just wasn't to the level of past Lethal Lockdown matches. And then, of course, the World Title match wasn't an amazing match, but the finishing segment was so cool. It was so good. I loved it. I don't know. Maybe other people think, I know people have mixed views on it, but I thought it was just an awesome way to finish this pay-per-view. I'm going to give it a 7 out of 10. It was a good show. I don't have an amazing amount of complaints. I will say that the middle of it was like, gah, with obviously the Robbie's match, as well as Joseph Park, Joey Ryan. I would have liked to see a little more steel cage, but at least they saved the 3 steel cage matches for the end, because those are, you know, that's what we're really here to see. And at least there was 3 steel cage matches, not like one, and it was over, and like, it was, I think, an hour and a half of the pay-per-view, or we very close to that, was all steel cage. Yeah, it wasn't every match, but it was at least three out of the eight, which is almost half the card. So I'm not going to complain that much about that. Just I would have liked to see maybe at least one or two more. At least maybe the X Division title or the World Tag titles. I mean, it's hard to have a lot of guys in the cage at once. I get that. Obviously, the Lethal Lockdown match felt very crowded, but I digress. It was a good pay-per-view. I enjoyed it. So that's my thoughts on Lockdown. Let me know what you guys thought of Lockdown down below in the comments section, as well as be sure to hit the like button and subscribe for plenty more to come. That's going to do it for me on this one. Raw review tomorrow, so stay tuned. That is it. So everybody have a nice evening, and I'll see you later. Peace out.